Good vibrations.
Welcome back to the podcast, and it's fourth time round for my guest today. We last spoke on the 20th of March, almost a couple of months ago. So I'm back with Michael O'Bernicia, the Bernician. Welcome back, brother.
It's a pleasure to be here, Mark. Thanks for inviting me.
No worries. So you reached out to me a couple of days ago and said that you're ready to give an update on your private criminal prosecutions case against the four horsemen of the COVID apocalypse, Hancock, Whitty, Vallance and Ferguson. So I'm looking forward to hearing what's been going down on that front, but I know you wanted to talk about an outrageous act of sabotage that's happened in the case just recently. So do you just want to bring me and the listeners up to speed on everything that's gone on since we last spoke on the 20th of March?
I will, but I must warn everybody who's listening that it is a roller coaster, so be prepared for the ride. Because when you're dealing with legal wars of attrition, whether they are in the civil or the criminal domain, you have, over the course of time, experience teaches you to prepare yourself for every single eventuality. Now, some of the more observant listeners might already know, others, it may come as a surprise to find out that I'm working with an ex-CID fraud detective on the case, who I've been working with for the past couple of years. We met over a mutual war that we were waging against various banks, including Bank of Scotland, relating to institutionalized mortgage fraud. And again, for those of you who don't know who are listening, I made a film about my experiences and others battling institutionalized mortgage fraud over a 9-year period, at the end of which I was successful in proving an argument in the High Court, which effectively established that the vast majority, if not all, of the 11.2 million registered mortgages in the UK are not only void, they're void because they're fraudulent. And the entire mortgage industry has been perpetrating a gigantic fraud for decades. And the fraud is so rampant that the vast majority of the legal professions have no clue that it's going on. Therefore, you battle a certain amount of cognitive dissonance persuading those type of professionals that they have erred in their judgment when they tell you that your arguments are completely without merit. Now, the reason I'm beginning there is because myself and the ex-fraud detective have exactly the same experiences. Even before we met each other, we were experiencing various things in the civil courts where we were fighting the mortgage battle, where we would have strange events take place. For instance, we would send a certain document to one of our adversaries, and then they would very often claim that it hadn't been received, for instance. That's the thin end of the wedge. The thicker end of the wedge is attempts to make us bankrupt by alleging things that weren't true, by attempting to make us liable for things we weren't liable for. And this often involved abject breaches of the law, which were completely overlooked. And the record would state nothing more than we had our cases dismissed as totally without merit. Now, totally without merit is a phrase that is very common, especially in the civil jurisdiction. And they use this expression, totally without merit, because every time a judge dismisses a case as totally without merit in the civil division, and of course in the criminal one, they have to make a decision as to whether the litigant responsible for the action should have a civil restraint order of some description slapped on them. Now, everybody that I know who's been fighting mortgage fraud for the best part of the last 10 years on the front line has either been threatened with a civil restraint order to try and shut them up, or they've had one imposed upon them. Now, 2 years before, we had the first mortgage cancelled on the grounds that I'd drafted and sustained in the High Court, a certain High Court judge called Norris J imposed a 2-year extended civil restraint order upon me to stop me making any actions in the civil courts without the permission of a gatekeeper judge that he appointed. Now, he happened to appoint a gatekeeper judge who had already thrown the arguments out repeatedly as totally without merit. So he was basically rigging the system in order to stop me appearing in court and continuing to fight, because every time the judges would throw my arguments out as totally without merit, I would either appeal it, take it to judicial review, or I would start a completely new action. We also brought actions at the land registry to have the fraudulent mortgages cancelled concurrently. We also brought an action into the property chamber to challenge some of the decisions of the land registrar when he initially refused to cancel the fraudulent mortgages. And we got to a certain point in time where my adversaries, they thought they'd won. Because for those of you who haven't seen The Great British Mortgage Swindle, and I'll give Mark a link to the version that you can see for free until the end of all this lockdown shite. I'll give you that at the end of the show, so anyone who hasn't seen it can watch it for free. But if you do watch it, what you will see is that justice isn't handed down in this rigged system. It's won through war of attrition. In other words, you don't win because a judge holds his hands up and says, you know what, all this time, all these other judges and barristers and lawyers have been saying you were full of shit, and now I finally realize they're all wrong and you're right. Here's the judgment, costs awarded against the bank. That's not the way it works. The way it works is you have to force your adversaries into a corner from which they can only emerge in defeat of some description. And for that reason, you need to be prepared for every single eventuality. So the reason that I'm making that introduction should be clear to the critical thinkers out there is because myself and the ex-CID detective, having had that experience, we sat down at the very beginning when we filed the PCP for pandemic fraud in March. We sat down prior to filing it and we agreed upon what the most likely outcomes were at each stage of the proceedings. Now, in the criminal courts, it's very different to the civil courts in one particularly relevant way. And that is, in the civil courts, you never go before a jury. So you're always relying upon the integrity of a judge for your decision. And what we've experienced is that it's not just that there are paid stooges within the civil judiciary who are working for the banks. There are judges and barristers who've been sponsored by the banks since the beginning of their career, and sometimes since the beginning of their education in the law, to fight people like us, because they knew there'd come a day when it would become so obvious that one particular act, a statute called the Law of Property Miscellaneous Provisions Act 1989, which prescribes in sections 1 and 2 that A, no mortgage deed is valid unless it is properly witnessed, and B, no mortgage contract is valid unless it is signed by both the bank and the mortgagor. Now, given that those two things are virtually never the case in any mortgage documents that you ever look at, we've got a case of institutionalized mortgage fraud. So imagine that all of the legal professionals who we came up against and all of the judges were denying that the very act that the Law Commission spent years developing to hold the banks to account, because mortgage fraud has always been so rampant, was being ignored by everybody except people like me, who were fighting on, and Michael O'Dara, who was the very first man to take this argument into the courts in this country. And of course, he's also covered in the film. His story's covered in the film, as is Tom Crawford's and the Albert family, all of whom fought bravely on the front line for many years and had exactly the same experiences. So we get to this point where we're coming in with charges of pandemic fraud into the criminal domain. And we only, the great difference that I was alluding to is that we only have one judge to get past. Whereas if you fail at the first hurdle with one judge in the civil domain, there'll be another judge that's wheeled out to give the same decision. And from that point onwards, they'll refuse to give you a hearing. Well, we only have to get past one judge in the criminal domain for a PCP to proceed. And the particular judge in this case is the Deputy Chief Magistrate. Now, the deputy chief magistrate is the second highest magistrate in the country. And he has the responsibility of deciding whether or not there is enough prima facie evidence for the case to proceed. Now, just to fill in the background, we filed in March. First of all, we filed an electronic version of the statement of case with a covering letter, which explained that because of the amount of evidence we had to file, they weren't capable of accepting it electronically. So the three files of evidence, along with the hard copy of the statement of case and the covering letter, were being forwarded by Royal Mail Special Delivery the following week. So we initially didn't get any confirmation except a standard email that comes back automatically that the electronic filing had been received. But when we sent the hard copies the following week, as I've documented on my blog with photographic evidence, including the mail receipt and the sign for part of the track and trace app at Royal Mail, basically they acknowledged receipt of it, and we made further inquiries, and we found out that it was initially it went to the legal team at Westminster Magistrates Court, which was the court where we filed it. And so we assumed that everything was as it should be. Now, 1 week ticked past, and then another. And obviously, we understand, because we empathize greatly with anybody who is impatient that this is taking too long. And, you know, it is taking too long. There are people dying as a result of the crimes that are being perpetrated. It's an urgent matter. But despite that fact, we have to also acknowledge that we condensed what was originally 1,300 pages down to a little over 800 pages because we found a way to simplify the evidence from its first form. And we also, but despite that, we still acknowledge that, you know, 800 odd pages of evidence is a lot for anybody to go through, especially given the seriousness of the allegations made. So after a couple of weeks, we decided, well, we'll send an email and we'll find out what the situation is. And we were told that the evidence bundle, in other words, the whole case, had been sent to Bromley Magistrates Court, who specialise in running PCPs that are filed at Westminster. And we were even told by a member of the legal department that this was always the way, once initial legal checks had been done at Westminster by their legal department, that it was automatically passed to Bromley's legal department, but also the listings department at Bromley, who told us on the phone, a very helpful woman who has become our liaison between the two courts, she informed us that we should expect a case number to be issued soon, and that it had been sent to them for listing. In other words, the listing of the first hearing of the case. Now, obviously, given our position, this was extremely encouraging news, especially when one considers what I've already alluded to, the amount of miscarriages of justice that we've already dealt with in the civil domain and that we were prepared for in the criminal domain. It was very encouraging, to say the least. Now, we waited another week or so, and then we received a very odd piece of communication from Westminster Court. And that communication was from another member of the legal department telling us that the deputy chief magistrate had made his mind up and the order was attached. So we opened the order, and the order stated that, and again, get ready for the roller coaster ride, the order stated that the case had been dismissed on the ground that we didn't cite enough prima facie evidence in support. In other words, the same reason that was given for the dismissal of the Hancock arrest warrant application before Christmas,
which you'd spent weeks putting together, which is why the whole thing is being dragged out so long.
Yes, exactly. And so we looked very carefully at the language in the order, and we immediately noticed there was something that just jumped off the page. And that was that the judge stated in his order that he had carefully considered all 126 pages of the evidence submitted. Well, 126 pages is the length of the statement of case. In other words, the electronic filing is 126 pages long. When that's added to the evidence bundle, the pages come to in excess of 800. So clearly there'd been a mistake. Now, every other time that a judge had made a mistake like this in the civil domain, in our experience, they'd made it pretty much deliberately, or they were too arrogant to even consider that they might have made a mistake. And they always said to us, once an order is made, there's no reconsidering it. You will have to appeal it or take it to judicial review if you had no right of appeal left. But instead of doing that, we decided we'd write a very gentle and reasonable email to our liaison at Bromley Court, telling them that quite clearly there'd been a mistake, that it appeared to us very obvious that through no fault of the judge, the bundle of evidence had been separated from the electronic filing, and the proof was in his order. He claimed that he'd read all 126 pages, when if he'd read all of the evidence, he would have read in excess of 800. So we suggested that rather than making us appeal the judgment, the judge should simply set aside his initial decision and reconsider it upon the evidence that he should have received. And I must admit, Mark, that at that point in time, all logic is screaming in my head. This is just another railroad. This is exactly what they've done, knuckled down for a proper war of attrition. And I'm not saying that that still might not be the case. And we are still prepared for it, obviously. But my instinct, which is what's kept me alive to this point in time, so I always trust it, because when it's unimpeded by what I want to be true in my head, my instinct is always correct. And it's the same for everybody when they rely on their instinct. My instinct, as the instinct of the guy, the ex-fraud detective who I'm working with, was exactly the same. We both said to each other, this feels like it's not going to go the way of a miscarriage of justice. And lo and behold, within a very short period of time, within a day, I believe it was within a day, we heard back from our liaison who confirmed that the judge had agreed to reconsider the case upon the evidence he should have received, and that the first decision had been set aside without us having to apply for that. In other words, Mark, for people in our position, for untrained litigants in person, to get a criminal judge at his level of seniority to do that, to give reconsideration to a case this serious, it's a major result. A major result. There isn't even an application you can make to have a judge do this. You simply rely upon their discretion. And for them to exercise their discretion to do something like this, they must have integrity. Because let's face it, if this judge was working for our adversaries or was being controlled by our adversaries, all he had to do was say, no, I'm sorry, I've made my mind up. Your only option is to appeal. And he didn't do that. So that gives us great heart indeed.
Sure. Well, a friend shared your most recent written update from your website on the case, and he made the following observations in his message. He said, well done, Bernician, and also the judge who readmitted the evidence. Perhaps that judge will now realize that there are elements of refined cowardly corruption masquerading as impartial law in his or her system. If those who tried to hide this evidence believed it was ineffectual, they would not have tried to stifle it. So they have de facto and inadvertently admitted that this prosecution is a genuine threat to those who govern us by lies and suppression. And I'm pretty sure you'd go along with that sentiment.
Wholeheartedly. In fact, I've got the shivers up my arms as I was listening to that. And it's not just because I live in the frozen north either.
Indeed. So we appear to have a case of deliberate sabotage here. Do we know the identity of the individual who might have tried to hide this evidence? And if we can discover who that was, what is likely to happen to them?
The short answer to that is no, purely because you can imagine that whoever made the decision or carried out the decision to separate the evidence from the statement of case, they knew, because it's within any department of lawyers, and it's almost certainly going to have happened within probably, I would say, Westminster legal department, that someone there knew that the statement of case, even if all the arguments were correct, could not be allowed to proceed without the evidence backing it up. And the simple reason for this is without at least two independent witness statements backing up the allegations, you haven't got a case. Now, we've got 11 expert witnesses in the who've put witness statements into the case. So what I'm suggesting is that someone read all that at Westminster and they saw the sustainability of the arguments with all of those witness statements from those experts in support, and they could see no good reason why any judge who wasn't dodgy as hell was going to rule against it. So in other words, they identified what the problem was for them. The problem for them was, if this evidence goes forward with this witness statement, this is going to proceed. So the problem they needed to solve was that problem. So they simply separated the evidence from the statement of case. So it could only have happened really within Westminster Magistrates Court. And bear in mind, we were told that it had gone to Bromley for listing. Now, we only found out from Bromley that they weren't meaning to tell us this, because at the time, you know, we hadn't elaborated on what we believed to be the case. But we know that it didn't happen. We're 99% certain that it didn't happen because of anybody at Bromley Court, because Bromley Court seemed just as surprised as us when they were told that the Deputy Chief Magistrate had already made his mind up on a case that they were sent to list for a hearing and to give a number to give a case number to. So they were just as surprised as us, which I think is why they were so. There was a kind of a very mooted relief that our liaison had, because I think she was somewhat confused when we initially told her, but once she'd seen the explanation that we gave, she completely concurred and sent it straight to the judge, and it would appear that the judge completely concurred. Now, if I was the judge, this is the first thing that I would have thought when I found out through receiving the email that we sent what had transpired. Why would anybody want to separate the statement of case from the evidence bundle? The only reasonable conclusion anybody of a reasonable intelligence would make is that they didn't want him to see the evidence. Now, if I was him, that would make me pretty angry, especially given the allegations being made, and especially if, which we can't guarantee, we don't know how he's going to go, we don't know who's leaning on him or who might lean on him, but we do know that he had sufficient integrity to set aside his initial decision. That shows he doesn't have the normal level of arrogance that members of the judiciary have in our experience. That also shows that he wanted to do the right thing and have a good look at what it was that was in the evidence file before he makes his mind up. But when he gets to that point, if I was him, I'd want to know who was responsible for this. Now, we can't find out because it's private information that only people in the court can possibly find out. And even then, it'll be a matter of, you know, only certain senior members within the court will be able to find out the information required. But that judge has the necessary authority to do the digging and to find out who it was that sent it to Bromley when it should have gone with the electronic filing, the statement of case. And of course, there was a hard copy of the statement of case in the hard copy bundle, just to make sure. But both should have gone to the judge at the first bite of the cherry. So it's a very interesting situation to answer what would happen to someone within the court. Well, if it became public knowledge, they might end up going to prison because it's, it's a difficult crime to assess. But it's certainly dishonest. It's certainly attempting to pervert the course of justice. And simply an allegation of perverting the course of justice is enough to get someone sent to prison if found guilty by a jury. So that could be the worst case scenario for whoever's done it. Now, I also think from my own experience that it's highly unlikely that there's a team sitting there within the legal department at Westminster who conspired to do this. The way they do it is they place, as I said, they place gatekeepers in these positions where they can do such things if and when required. Well, if we put it this way, when was the last time a case this serious was brought against a presiding, any officers of a presiding UK government? Never happened. Never happened. So it's not like they can rely on tried and tested techniques that they use behind the scenes to create a miscarriage of justice or to take a case that should go forward off the rails. They had to improvise because they weren't really sure what we were going to do, when we were going to do it, and how we were going to do it. But thankfully, because of the copious amount of planning that we did, we were prepared for such an eventuality, whether it involved fighting it or whether we were able to achieve through a very gentle recourse the result that we have. But either way, it's not looking good for someone in Westminster Magistrates Court who I think if they end up listening to this podcast, or even if they don't, it'll be squeaky bum time.
Be lots of laundry to be done with their smalls. And this is the thing with gatekeepers. Often they are put into a position and they end up being like a sleeper. And sometimes it could be for years until they're called upon to step into their required role. They can just keep their head down and burrow themselves into the furniture. And then, you know, their moment comes eventually. This is how it's often done. On your website, you've posted a picture of three large blue lever arch files full of documents. Is that what we're talking about having gone missing here, the contents of those files?
It is. They didn't exactly go missing. They went to Bromley, but they were missing at Westminster, yes.
Indeed. Right. Okay. So that's what we're talking about. And an important message you want to get across to people here then is that this PCP case can be won, because you've got a previous track record in this regard. And as we just mentioned there, the very fact that somebody would feel the need to go to these lengths to bury the evidence when they could well go to jail if they're ever found out does rather suggest that you've rattled a few cages and got the control system a bit phased.
There's no doubt about that. And I keep getting told exactly that by supportive members of the legal professions who are coming forward and letting me know exactly that the establishment are rattled. They weren't prepared for this. They never imagined it would even be possible for anyone to get their heads around exactly what had happened, never mind to put together the evidence the way we have. And I must immediately pay tribute to all the people who have helped behind the scenes. And there are too many who've offered their support to name, but they all know who they are, and they will all get the credit they deserve at the end of this, because this is that people ask all the time that how is it that I'm so certain that we'll win? And I can give practical reasons, which I'll come back to. But the instinctive reason is that throughout my entire life, it doesn't matter what anybody else's experience has been, whenever I've known I was right and I was faced with insurmountable odds, and the only way that I could overcome adversity was to do things that people considered impossible at the outset. My experience has been, as long as my belief in what the truth was didn't waver, then I can overcome whatever odds stand in my way. And it just so happens that the guy that I'm working with, the ex-fraud detective, is exactly of the same bent, as are the hardcore team that I'm working with behind the scenes on the research and the data and putting it all together. Because it would have been impossible for one man to pull all of this off. However, there are also practical reasons why, once we get past the first judge, as I was saying, once this judge allows this case to proceed before a jury, there is absolutely no way that any jury that hasn't been rigged to get the result that our adversaries want, and there's no known case where that has happened in this country, to the best of my knowledge, but provided it's a jury that hasn't been bought, the evidence is not just substantive, it's overwhelming. The pandemic fraud has been committed on multiple counts of fraud by false representation and fraud by non-disclosure, and most importantly, that the effect of convicting the four horsemen of COVID-1984 of pandemic fraud will be that people are forced to agree that the primary consequence of those frauds has been mass murder by government policy And all of the evidence points to the fact that that was deliberate. Now, the reason why, from a practical point of view, that that situation is different to any situation that could arise in the civil domain is, as I said, there's no jury in a civil case. And the reason for that is because the only common law court that's left on these shores is the common law jury court. So it's all we've got left. So in other words, one decision by one judge, the deputy chief magistrate, to allow this to proceed will mean that this case is going to go before a common law jury. So in other words, it's not a judge who decides. It's not a room full of people who've got, like Sage, who've got vested interests in Big Pharma. It's nothing that can be influenced by anything other than the evidence. And quite simply, there is no reasonable mind in existence that would not conclude that the four horsemen are guilty as charged. That's why they're so petrified of this going forward.
So if Hancock, Whitty, Vallance, Ferguson go to jail, how the hell do you think the mainstream media would handle that? Because they would have to report it. They couldn't ignore something like that. So how do you think they would frame it? Because they'd just go into panic meltdown mode, wouldn't they?
Yes. We've detected along the way certain moments of panic and meltdown. You will have noticed a few weeks ago, in fact, not long after we last spoke, that there was a seeming U-turn from Whitty, who'd been saying, oh, you got to get used to the fact there'll be more lockdowns later in the year. And then he did a U-turn and said, no, there won't be any more lockdowns. Now, I know they're playing psychological warfare. You know, they're giving people, they're dangling a golden carrot in front of people's noses saying, just do what you're told and then it'll all be over. And then they're taking it away to demoralize people. But this did seem more like it was panic stations than anything else. In fact, some people at the time were suggesting, has he taken legal advice on his position? Because it's so easy to prove that he's been in the pocket of Big Pharma since the beginning, his whole career, just the same as Ferguson, just the same as Vallance, that their entire careers have been working for Big Pharma or in service of Big Pharma agendas. Now, this isn't just a bold allegation, of course. We can prove this in the minutest detail, but Vallance is the most obvious of the lot. How can it be that it's not a conflict of interest for Patrick Vallance to leave GSK after being president, I believe, for 4 years? Was it 4 years? It may have been 6 years that he was president. But having been responsible for numerous vaccine rollouts across the world, which caused terrible, fatal adverse events and also non-fatal adverse events that resulted in the onset of terminal illness when there'd been nothing wrong with the people before they were injected. There's just no way that Vallance doesn't know what he's doing. And there's also no way that it can't be considered a blatant conflict of interests that he walked away from his position as president of GSK with, what was it, $600,000 worth of shares? And according to Hancock, of course, that doesn't represent a conflict of interest. But then again, he would say that because he also claims that being friends with all the companies who've made so much money from the taxpayer in the PPI contracts, he also claims that it's not a conflict of interest for him to have personal and business relationships with them all. So he would say that. But Ferguson's history is not just of creating or participating in the creation of mathematical models which predicted completely fraudulent contagions. Not only that, there is no part of Ferguson's career that hasn't been funded by Big Pharma. And in particular, the Gates Foundation. Gates Foundation obviously has a long-term partnership with GSK, which was set into stone when Patrick Vallance was president. And the Gates Foundation and the Wellcome Trust are pretty much behind every single aspect of the research, development, and manufacturing of what we know to be potentially lethal. I'm not going to call them vaccines because they're not vaccines, treatments.
What do you make of Bill and Melinda Gates announcing they're getting divorced? Because the way many people have interpreted that is Bill Gates feels that certain parties might be trying to come after him because of all the damage that his vaccination program has caused. And he's trying to protect his wealth by putting it in Melinda's name or shuffling it around. Would that be a reasonable interpretation of what's going on there in your view?
I certainly don't think it's unreasonable. That it's not my view. I wouldn't rule it out. It's certainly a possibility. But again, my instinct told me something else. And there's something that I want to connect it with, because prior to this happening, it was a week or two before, we saw the first picture of Ghislaine Maxwell when she was, I believe, being taken from a courtroom to the prison. And if you saw it, you'll have seen that she had one of those now infamous black marks under her eye. And whatever that does or doesn't mean, she looked for the very first time in any picture since that was taken of her since the beginning of this to be petrified, scared, for whatever reason. Now, my instinct told me at the time, what if she's actually squealed on one of the big time operators who went to Pedophile Island, who she and Epstein had copious amounts of evidence against, which is, of course, the reason why they set it up for the Secret Services so they could bribe millionaires and billionaires and trillionaires when they needed to. Well, what if she's blown the whistle on a big name who's going to be the patsy for them all? And of course, the next week, we hear Bill and Melinda are getting divorced. And then this week, we hear from her lawyers that they're leaking this out. They've leaked it to the New York Times and others, saying this has been going on ever since the allegations that Gates was guilty of the same crimes as Epstein came to the surface. And the reason that she's divorcing him is because it's also come out that he's apparently been a sexual predator, chasing women who work for Microsoft, and that reason, along with the fact that he was alleged to have visited Pedophile Island multiple times and met with Epstein, that's now come out over 200 times at least since 2011 he's met with him. Well, if that's the case, perhaps Gates is going to be their patsy, and that's going to be the huge distraction from everything else that's going on already.
Wouldn't that be a beautiful thing? 72-hour party around my place, if that ever happens.
I'll be there.
And also a party if Hancock, Whitty, Vallance and Ferguson go to jail. And if that should happen, where would that actually leave Johnson in all of this?
I think Johnson is to me, he appears like a man who he knows that he's not in control of any of it. I think he's trying to make himself unelectable. I also think that during certain moments where he loses his rag, he shows the influence that his genocidal dad has had upon him. And then, of course, you've got all the speeches that he's made talking about what the importance of population reduction, that's one of the most serious issues that people are ignoring. And that was way before he came to Downing Street. But I honestly believe that whatever he intended to do as prime minister, he had no idea that once he got there, his strings were being pulled by the City of London, which, of course, is a euphemism for the Rothschild cartel. So what Johnson does, I don't think it can be predicted except in one respect. Whatever he does, it will be self-serving. He doesn't do anything unless it's self-serving. And if the best thing he can do to save his own ass is sing like a canary when this proceeds to court, that's exactly what he'll do. And I don't even believe that the supposed spat between him and Cummings is real, because I think Cummings left the government for the same reason Johnson wants to leave, but they don't want him to leave because they want to continue using him as a puppet.
Sounds reasonable. So the control system is putting on a brave public face. They're continuing to pump up the tyranny. They're not giving any indication that they've been fazed by either your case or any other methods of resistance that have been happening, such as doctors and other whistleblowers coming forward, people sharing accounts of the adverse reactions that they've had to the vaccines, the protest events continuing to gather momentum, all of this. And having promised us our freedoms back come the 21st of June, we're now getting all these rumours about an Indian variant, with the notion that this will conveniently get out of control just in time to prevent things from opening up again in June. So it seems the more we the people push back through whatever means, whether it's your case or any of these other methods, they double down and they cause even more harm and loss. And it almost feels like they're saying, oh yeah, you want to come for us? You think you can take us on? Well, have some of this. It's like they're taunting us. Do you ever get that feeling?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. To them, this is their sport. You know, they're causing the harm that they're causing when most of the people believe that they're, or I wouldn't say it's most now, but it has been a majority most of the way through COVID-1984 have believed that they were doing things for their own benefit when nothing could be further from the case. People should also understand that it was no different fighting the banks. It was no different. We had their lawyers and their barristers and their judges sneering down their noses. You'll never get anywhere with this. You untrained, dirty little oik. You know, it was that kind of attitude. They absolutely despised us, but they despised me for one very particular reason. And that was, no matter what they said, no matter what they did, I don't give up until I win, because I don't start the battle until I know for a fact I have the forces required to do it. Now, that might seem, as I say, an impossible feat at the beginning to most. It may seem to others just a complete flight of fancy. And again, I understand, but I really don't give a shit what anybody else says or thinks. At the end of the day, I'm going to do what's right. Even if I was a minority of one, I'd still be doing this, because I know there's going to come a point when we start releasing the evidence that we have in this case. We already have the numbers in this country alone to make sure that that information gets to millions of people, and they will see how the accused are absolutely banged to rights. And when that happens, you see, inevitably, if the establishment refuses to let the right thing happen, let's just say we get the go-ahead from the deputy chief magistrate to move to trial, and then they suddenly suspend the common law jury trial until further notice to stop it going forward. Or they create a law which prevents prosecution of criminality by any government officer, any civil servant, under any circumstances. In other words, to legislate for the crimes that they've been committing covertly. Exactly like they did with that bill that they created, the kill bill, they gave themselves the right of government officers to commit crimes of any and all natures, which could obviously encompass killing people, taking people out who were a threat to government policy or a threat to government agenda. They've already attempted it, and they haven't enforced it yet. And the reason they haven't enforced it is because the people we see on the front line, but rolling out all this bullshit, they're all having their strings pulled. In other words, there's probably a gun at their head behind the scenes if they don't go along with this, or they know there would be if they didn't get with the program, as it were, and they've been offered all kinds of material rewards for doing what they're doing, and including the media as well, because there's people should also have no illusions about what will happen at the end of all this when we secure the convictions, and it will be a when. If the establishment doesn't react, then we have the circumstances required under international law to seek intervention in this country, because there's genocide being committed. Now, we have to get to the point where all possible remedies have been exhausted before we could hope to get any kind of reaction from any other nation. But let's just put it this way. Things aren't anywhere near this bad in Switzerland, because the Swiss have a different system of government. And that system of government involves having regions called cantons, and each region is autonomous and can opt out of any part of the law if there's a referendum on the subject, and they say that the people of that canton say they want to do so. The other thing that's very pertinent about the situation in the Swiss cantons, and I have one of my oldest friends who lives in Geneva, and he's the one who told me this, that if you don't do national service in Switzerland, where both men and women learn to, they basically learn to handle arms, guns, they're trained to shoot properly when they're doing the national service. If you emigrate there, then you have to go through a canton government course teaching you the use of every different type of firearm. Then when you graduate the course, you have to keep and maintain the weapons in your house. And there are regular random inspections to make sure that you're doing it. And what is the, what I said to my friend, what is the purpose of this? What, why does this happen? And he says, well, that is the most amazing thing, Michael, because if someone had told me, I wouldn't have believed them, but it happened to me. So I'm telling you, it's the truth. Basically, I asked, why do I have to do this? I didn't particularly want to do it, but I enjoyed it when I did, because they said to me, look, everyone has to do it. There's no choice. You've got to leave the country if you don't do it, because we're teaching you to shoot to kill if ever the government of Switzerland gets tyrannical and comes to get you. And the targets that he was trained to shoot at had pictures of tyrannical government officers on them. And that's what they had to aim at. So it's that blatant. But, you know, they know this is the reason Switzerland has remained largely out of global conflicts for so long, when in prior centuries, they were the number one nation to get mercenaries from. This is why they've done it. The people said no, and they localized the power, and they retained the right to bear arms, which, of course, was taken. Well, it hasn't technically been taken away from us because of the Bill of Rights. But if anyone carries a weapon and you get caught by the police, you're likely to go to prison for a number of years.
Yeah, what a complete contrast between the situation there and the situation here and most other countries, actually.
Yes, absolutely. And it's also, it's not just a coincidence that Texas, where the population owns more guns per head than anywhere else in the States, has said, fuck all this shit before everybody else. And look at the results they're having.
Yeah.
Cases
disappeared. Connection there.
Yep, definitely.
Have you been encouraged by what's happening in other countries, particularly the Rainer Fulmich case in Germany? And do you think it would just take one domino effect to cause all the others to come crashing down? So supposing he had success in his case, would that cause everything to collapse in, you know, everywhere else? Or if you have success, would it cause that action to take place in other countries? Do you think it just takes one of these to be successful?
That depends. That depends on what the overall agenda is. I am very encouraged that there are very obvious synergies between the arguments that he's making and his team are making and the arguments that we are making. I'm very aware of the PCR test fraud, and I'm pretty certain that they've identified that Drosten was key to that PCR test fraud. But the one thing that it appears that virtually nobody knows at the moment, or nobody has realized, is without the actions of the four horsemen who we are alleging fraud against, none of it could have happened worldwide, including the PCR scam. None of it could have happened. That the origins of it are with those four. Had those four not behaved the way they did, the rest of it couldn't happen. And that's why I don't believe that anyone who isn't taking that into account in their allegations is going to succeed, because the others weren't the cause of the fraud. Even though they're making the right allegation, the others weren't the cause of the fraud, because it couldn't have happened. They would not have been able to commit the frauds that they did if the perpetrators in our case hadn't committed the frauds that they did. I am very encouraged, though, because I do think there'll come a point in time, and I would welcome it, if Fulmich and I and or one of his team and one of our team got together and just compared notes, compared evidence. I'm pretty certain that they would agree that the evidence is interchangeable, and I've drafted the case in such a way that it would be. So if you're asking me, do I think that things will stop here if the Fulmich case succeeds outside of this country? My instinct says no. Do I think that everywhere else it will stop in the event we succeed in the PCP here? No, I don't, instinctively. But if we stop it here, or when we stop it here, I do believe that that will create a domino effect. That because the evidence, all of the evidence by that point in time will all be public, because people will have easy access to it. We're going to encourage legal teams, including Fulmich's legal team, to take the same evidence and use it in their jurisdiction the best way they can. But the one thing that I do agree with them on, more than any other, is that the denouement of this, whatever domestic success we have taken the bastards down for what they're doing, it's still going to take genocide tribunals. And at the moment, as I've alluded to in one of my blog posts, at the moment, because of the repeal of the Genocide Act 1969 in this country, which took place on the 1st of the 9th, 2001, 10 days before the staged event of 9/11, because of that, there's no way to extradite any serving or former government officers to The Hague or to anywhere else, even to Nuremberg too. There's no legal recourse to do that, even under international law, because when they repealed the Genocide Act on the 1st of September 2001, they took out the singular clause which allowed anybody, regardless of status, including the sovereign and prime minister, etc. It enabled the indictment for crimes against humanity and genocide to The Hague. And when they repealed that act, they took it out and no one breathed a whisper of it. But the proof of that is, I'm sure some of your listeners at least know, that there is a maverick barrister who specializes in human rights issues called Michael Mansfield QC. And Michael Mansfield, a few years ago, brought a PCP phone on behalf of a retired Iraqi general alleging crimes of humanity against Tony Blair, his attorney general, and their accomplices. And the court ruled, and by the way, Mansfield's PCP got chucked out before the stage that we're at. It got chucked out straight away on the ground that under English law, there was absolutely no way that those particular people, Blair and his accomplices, could be held accountable even after they'd served the time in their various offices. Now that means, because there's been no change to the law since then, it means that anybody bringing an ICC complaint to The Hague, even if the Hague's judges and lawyers rule that the evidence is there to indict, they don't have the jurisdiction to do it, because of the repeal of that Genocide Act.
Right. So your case is alleging fraud. Are you also alleging crimes against humanity, or does that come under the category of genocide?
We're alleging pandemic fraud, but we're also alleging that the primary consequence of those frauds is mass murder by government policy. So in other words, when we nail them for fraud, we're going to immediately indict them for mass murder by government policy, democide by another name, which is a common law offence.
And it really seems like the UK has been at the centre of this whole COVID scandemic, from what you're saying there. The whole PCR test fraud, you know, none of this could have happened worldwide if it hadn't been cooked up and masterminded right here in this wretched land. It really is the centre point of it all.
Yes, but the actual... The pandemic fraud of creating the illusion of the government lurgy, that originated here as well, as did every single one of the killer jabs currently in circulation. They all originated here. We've traced even the ingredients of the vaccines. We've traced the development of what we believe to be the fatal ingredient in the 2019 to 21 flu jabs, which is something called MF59. I'm pretty certain I'm getting that right. And they also are including various other substances, which they escape my memory occasionally, but which are used in lethal injections on death row in the States and other places to stop the heartbeat, for instance. And all of this is documented. And when you find out that when people find out, we can actually trace that every single element of the dishonesty relied upon by the defendants has emanated from these shores. Even though both Whitty and Ferguson are in prime positions of power in the WHO, Whitty was appointed to the WHO executive after he was appointed chief medical officer, and they appointed him on the 1st of January 2020 to the executive, and that was the month after that executive had voted to aggressively implement the new WHO plan to immunize the world, which is exactly in accordance with the plan of Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, and the plan of the Gates Foundation, which needs no more explanation. And each of those institutions or foundations are also interconnected with the Rothschild cartel. In fact, we've managed to trace the origins of the killer ingredients in the flu vaccines, the flu injections. And we are highly suspicious that the same ingredient has been secretly added to the COVID injections as well. And we can trace the origins of this, that it was put into the first stage of development by the Rothschild cartel, who are behind all of those institutions, without which none of those institutions could even function worldwide.
All right, Michael. Well, I want to thank you for coming on today and bringing us up to speed and putting everything so eloquently, so clearly, so that everyone can understand where we're at. I want to thank you for all the great work you're doing. I know all my listeners would like to second that. And I would just ask everyone listening to pray, to express your will and your intent, and make a statement of affirmation to the universe, to creation, for this case to succeed. Because if hundreds of thousands or millions of people get on the same page in terms of putting that wish, that hope, that desire out into the universe, the mechanisms of natural law that we have will conspire to bring about that physical manifestation that we all so desire. So in all seriousness, I would ask everyone listening to just focus their intent on the kind of outcome that we all want to see. And I really do believe that we can actually bring that about through the forces of nature. And again, I just want to thank you for coming on today and all the great work you're doing. I'm sure we'll catch up again in due course and see where we're at with everything. But just thanks again for jumping on today, brother.
I can't thank you enough, Mark. And just to let you know, as you were saying that, you gave me the shivers up my arms again. But this time I got them up my legs as well. That was very profound what you said there, because you're speaking the truth. It only ever happens when people are speaking the truth, that we can manifest this. We can manifest it even though it's never happened before, even though it seems like it's impossible, just through our own free will to manifest it and to be determined enough to do whatever it takes so that our children will wake up in a free land once again.
I mean, it's no random accidental thing that you were born when you were, that I was born when I was, that we both find ourselves in this country at this time, and that so many other people that are playing a role in the scenario that we're all now embroiled in are in this part of the world at this point in the timeline. This was all meant to be. This is all part of some greater plan, and we're all playing our role in it. Maybe that's another goosebumps moment, but that's how I feel about it.
I absolutely agree. Let's just say, in the great pub on the astral plane, we all got together, we had a good drink without doing any of the COVID bullshit. And we said, you know what? We're going to go and we're going to commit at this particular time to fight this battle, to do it peacefully, because we all know what happens from previous lives, previous experiences, what it's like when you have to fight violence with violence. Everybody suffers. And this is to avoid that. And I honestly do believe we all agree to come and do this. There's too many coincidences. I absolutely agree with what you said.
And in that great pub in the sky, everyone can buy you a virtual pint when this is all done.
Exactly. Even though my wife won't be very happy, because I'll not get home for weeks.
Oh, well, she'll be there with you. All right. Well, thank you again for coming on today.
Thanks a lot, Mark. And thanks for all your support. It really is greatly appreciated.
This is just begun. I'm picking up vibrations. I'm picking up vibrations.